Hello, I'm Peter Afrasiabi. I'm a partner with the law firm of One LLP, an intellectual property boutique with offices in Newport Beach, California, and Beverly Hills, California. Today's presentation is an ethics one, entitled, I'm Out of Order, You're Out of Order, Ethics and Civil Disobedience in and Out of the Court. You can see on our first slide here, we're going to start somewhere fun. We're going to start in the world of Hollywood. And we're going to look at an example of lawyering in terms of what you cannot do. So let me set the stage. For those of you who are not familiar with this movie and Justice for All and Al Pacino, here's all you need to know. Al Pacino plays a disillusioned criminal defense lawyer who's seen his client suffer in a broken criminal justice system, and he's frustrated and angry. And there's a particularly nasty judge that he deals with, the famous actor who was from the television show Dynasty in the 1980s, even though this movie is from the 1970s. And this judge is nasty and mean to Al Pacino, and Al Pacino has had to deal with the judge. Then one day, the judge is accused of rape. And Al Pacino, through a series of events in the movie, is forced to be the defense lawyer to represent the judge. And he's frustrated at this because the judge is a bad guy. And so here we have Al Pacino's opening statement. Let's let it roll.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, the prosecution is not going to get that man today. No. Because I'm going to get him. My client, the Honorable Henry T. Fleming, should go right to fucking jail. The son of a bitch is guilty. That man is guilty. That man there, that man is a slime. He is a slime. If he's allowed to go free, then something really wrong is going on.
Mr. Kirkland, you are out of order.
You're out of order. You're out of order. The whole trial is out of order. They're out of order. That man, that crazy, depraved man, raped and beat that woman there, and he'd like to do it again. He told me so. It's just a show. It's a show. It's, let's make a deal.
So, there you have it. It's a show. It's a show. It's an incredible example of Hollywood and the effects that Hollywood can have. But what it shows is the frustration of a lawyer, which all of us have felt before, obviously, as lawyers, at the legal system we inhabit, the rules, perhaps, that apply to our area, the substantive law, that is, the rules of evidence, the procedures, or the local rules of the judge in terms of the constraints placed upon us at trial. And we feel this great sense of unfairness at times that something is wrong and we're not getting a fair shake. Al Pacino is an example of what you cannot do, obviously, to your client or to the judge or to the legal system as a lawyer. But it's a fantastic clip to look at because it looks at this question of how do lawyers deal with unfairness, with social injustice and problems that they're confronting while staying within the realm of ethics as a lawyer, within our duties, that is. And so the question is, what is the quid pro quo that we give up as lawyers so that in order to get our bar card, we don't get to behave like Al Pacino anymore? That's for Hollywood or that's for non-lawyers. That's what we're going to look at today. And so let's look at today some examples of lawyers who have tripped some of the lines. And perhaps what you'll see at the end of this is, as fictional and fantastic as Al Pacino's role is in that film, as they say, truth is stranger than fiction sometimes. And we'll see some lawyers who've got pretty close to being Al Pacino's for you. So let's get going. You can see here on the first slide that ultimately we're looking at a broad set of issues today. And there's three massive categories we're going to look at. And that is the ethics of counseling as our first category, participating in as our second category, and then litigating civil disobedience matters and matters of high emotion, socioeconomic, sociopolitical, high tension trials. Now, of course, if we step back, lawyers are central and really have been since the Boston Tea Party to civil disobedience and rule changing. That's part of the fabric of the foundation of the Republic. But of course, ethical obligations have to be kept in mind, and they're critical as functional constraints on our behavior as lawyers and as citizens. And so the question ultimately that we're asking as we start walking through the program today is, do we as lawyers stand in the same place as any citizen? Or do we have ethical obligations to the rule of law that somehow we shed some of our rights, in other words, when we become a member of the bar? Is there that quid pro quo, and how far does it go, and where are the lines? And so this is what we're going to look at today. So we'll start by talking about our first bullet point today, and that's civil disobedience. What is it? How does it work in times of rulemaking, in times of social tension? And what is the intersection of civil disobedience with lawyering? We're going to look at civil disobedience both in terms of us as lawyers, as members of the bar, and as citizens concerned about the world wanting to participate in civil disobedience. What constraints are placed on us, of course, we'll look at. But we're also going to look at our role as lawyers, as advocates, when we perhaps are representing people who have been involved in civil disobedience and have tripped some legal wires and now must deal with the fallout and the litigation fallout, and our role as lawyers perhaps representing them or counseling them beforehand in terms of what their organizations are planning to do. So the first bucket is this bucket of counseling you see here that we're looking at, and it's revolving around our ethical obligations, lawyers' ethical obligations, when advising clients on the law, on breaking the law, and engaging in civil disobedience. After we do our module on counseling, we'll shift to participating. And there we'll look at both lawyers, but also judges, and so this is for our judges who are watching also, as first-party participants in civil disobedience and the ethics tripwires that we face. And then finally, we'll look at litigating. And we're going to look at lawyers' ethical obligations representing people when they are in pitched civil disobedience-type trials or social protest cases or cases coming out of immense civil disobedience events in society. And so we're going to look at two particular cases from history in terms of civil disobedience and massive periods of social anxiety and social political unrest, much like we've experienced today in 2020. And we're going to look first, we're going to go back to the 1960s to 1968 and the famous Chicago 7 trial, and ultimately the contempt charges that were brought against the lawyers representing the Chicago 7 in the riot cases that were brought against them in federal court coming out of the protests and the civil disobedience at the 1968 Democratic National Convention in Chicago. And then from the 1960s, we'll go back to another period of pitched social unrest and anxiety, and that's the Cold War, the Communist Scare, the Red Scare, and the Communist Witch Hunts of the 1940s and 50s. And we will there look at the famous case of Harry Bridges, and who had been put on trial repeatedly for being a member of the Communist Party in that great period of social unrest and anxiety about communism. And again, we will look then, telescoping in beyond Harry Bridges to his lawyer, famed criminal defense lawyer Vince Hallinan from San Francisco, and the contempt charges that were brought against Vince Hallinan that ultimately led to him actually being imprisoned. So in all of this, we're going to look at the ethical tripwires in all these realms for us as lawyers. So let's get going. And on the first slide, you can see here, we need to step back and talk about civil disobedience. What is it? There's a long history, of course, of social protesting in America as a means of affecting rule changes to our society. And civil disobedience provokes a societal response, and it provokes police rules, such as time, place, and manner restrictions imposed by governors or police or by localities. And those time, place, manner restrictions, perhaps on protesting, on engaging in gathering, are then intentionally flouted in order to make a point. And this is the root of what civil disobedience is. It's conduct that intentionally risks arrest to make a political statement. And civil disobedience, of course, has been a part of us since the founding of the Republic. The Boston Tea Party was itself an act of civil disobedience and rule flouting. And of course, in the last century, it's been a massive mechanism and part of effecting social change and ultimately changes to rules, to laws that we as lawyers are then engaging with and litigating and changing America. And so the question for us today is, where do we as lawyers fit into this, and what can we do and what can we not do? So let's look first at counseling. And this is our first slide, and this is the ethics rule from the California Rules of Professional Conduct. The New York rule is essentially identical but for one word, and you can see there I've marked it up in red. And both of these are based on the ABA, and so they're all following the ABA rule. So let's look at the verbiage. This is Rule 1.2.1. advising or assisting the violation of laws. And in California, the rule is that a lawyer shall not counsel a client to engage or assist a client in conduct that the lawyer knows is criminal, fraudulent, or a violation of any law, rule, or ruling of a tribunal. Now, New York's identical, but New York's actually broader. For those of you in New York, you have an even broader net cast upon you, in other words, because it's not the narrower word criminal, but it's the broader word illegal, which could conceivably encompass, of course, a range of conduct beyond being merely or significantly criminal, but to include non-criminal yet still illegal conduct. And then subsection B says, notwithstanding paragraph A, you may discuss the legal consequences of a proposed course of conduct with a client, and you may counsel or assist a client to make a good faith effort to determine the validity, scope, meaning, or application of a law. Now, here's what's critical. There's a massive distinction under this rule between presenting an analysis of legal aspects of questionable conduct and recommending the means by which a crime or a fraud might be committed with impunity. What this means is the fact that a client uses your advice in a course of action that is then criminal or fraudulent does not of itself make you a lawyer a party to that course of action. And so some lawyers think that we as lawyers cannot have anything to do with people who are considering civil disobedience. That, I think, under the ethics rules is not correct. What is accurate is that legal ethics say lawyers cannot assist people in breaking the law, but all lawyers advise people. And the ABA model rules of professional conduct, and then the California and New York rule that follows, and there are similar rules in all states, make it clear that we as lawyers can explain what the law is, and we can explain how it might be applied to people who are considering risking arrest in that course or conduct of behavior. So let's look at some case examples of improper advice of aiding and abetting in the breaking of law by lawyers. And so the first case we're going to look at comes from New York City. And this is the New York City Bar's Professional Judicial Ethics Opinion 1999-02. And let me tell you about what this case involves. The root case is about a lawyer who got charged with disciplinary proceedings for aiding a fugitive client in the sale of some assets and in defense of some civil litigation. And what the New York City Bar held, what the New York State Bar held, sorry, is that a lawyer may not assist a fugitive in selling assets unless the lawyer has a reasonable basis to believe the fugitive has a legal basis for his actions. And so when it comes to the sale of assets and the forwarding proceeds to a client, you can see here the quote from the New York Bar Court. We believe that a lawyer may represent and act on behalf of a fugitive client, notwithstanding the status as a fugitive, provided the lawyer does nothing to aid the client to escape prosecution or to further another illegal act. The committee agrees that a lawyer may ethically sell a client, even a fugitive client's, tangible assets and place the proceeds in escrow, but if the circumstances give rise to a basis for suspicion that the lawyer's conduct may be used to commit an illegal or fraudulent act, we do not believe the lawyer may transfer the proceeds from the sale to the client without first satisfying himself that there's some reasonable support for that course or conduct. The second component that the bar looked at was whether you can then represent the fugitive in civil litigation to avoid civil liability when the person's a fugitive. And here you can see the next quote from the New York bar ruling, and that is that although they noted some ethics committees have opined that a lawyer cannot represent a defendant so long as he remains a fugitive, New York says, we refuse to follow such reasoning. Instead, we believe that, consistent with the rules, the representation of a fugitive client in a civil matter does not require mandatory withdrawal, provided that such continued representation would not result in the violation of a disciplinary rule. So you can see what's important there is that aiding or abetting a client, in other words, who is seeking to sell assets, even if that client's a fugitive, can be done so long as the lawyer has a reasonable basis to believe that the legal advice given to help sell those assets is legal, and in New York, at least, the money is then flowing to an escrow account. The second opinion we're going to look at comes from Indiana. And here we have a lawyer who ultimately did face disciplinary charges and so has fallen on the other side of the line. And here the situation was as follows. The lawyer is representing the husband in a bitter custody dispute and battle. and there's a custody and visitation order that's been imposed, and the father of the child has to return the child at a certain date. And the father does not return the child upon the advice of the lawyer because the father believes the mother is engaged in abuse. The father says this, and so the lawyer advises him, do not return the child, even though the child had to be returned under the custody order on a particular day. They then went in ex parte before the judge, and the judge said, no, return that child to the mother right now. The lawyer still advised the client, don't do it until we have some sort of ruling by the criminal court, because the lawyer knew the criminal court was about to issue an indictment against the mother. Ultimately, an indictment was issued against the mother. It was then dismissed because there was no basis to justify the criminal charge. And the lawyer then was brought up on disciplinary hearings. And so here you can see the Q&A session before the tribunal when the lawyer was called before the court. And so first question, there's been some testimony you knowingly gave advice to violate the court order. Is that correct? That is correct. And then you can see it goes on. Well, why? Well, I mean, the prosecutor's office was going to look at it. We knew something was going to be filed, so we felt we could do it. So you advised him not to return his son despite the fact that there was a custody order existing? Yes. And on that basis, you advised him to do that despite the court order? Yes. And you knew there was an ex parte order signed by the judge? Yes. So you can see here, in other words, that you did not advise him to return the child. No, not on that date. That's the transcript. That led to the lawyer actually being held and subjected to disciplinary charges because the conduct was an intentional flouting of a rule and a violation of a court order. Now, interestingly, the lawyer there argued that, well, this is a civil dispute. It's not criminal. And you remember in 1.2.1, this is looking at criminal conduct. And the court said it doesn't matter because even though the case may technically be a civil case, the violation of that kind of a custody order has foreseeable criminal consequences. Indeed, the lawyer's client spent 90 days in jail for the willful refusal to return the child. And so the lawyer faced some disciplinary charges, a public censure. But what's interesting when you read the Indiana Supreme Court's decision is two Supreme Court justices dissented. They said that the lawyer got off too light and his conduct was outrageous and he should face some serious punishment because his advice led to his client sitting in jail for 90 days and some public reprimand, in other words, is simply not enough. And so you can see that depending upon the facts and circumstances in another jurisdiction, a lawyer could find himself being potentially disbarred for that type of conduct. Now, let's shift from there to case examples of no ethics violations on our next slide. Section 1.2, of course, implicitly allows non-criminal, non-fraudulent law-breaking advice. And there's no apparent cases in the nation of discipline under Section 1.2 or its analogs for non-criminal, non-fraudulent advice. Although, of course, remember, knowing violations of court orders can result in discipline under Section 1.2 because that's another prong of 1.2. But we can look at a fascinating case out of Alaska. And this helps define the fault lines for us as lawyers in terms of giving advice on breaking the quote-unquote law, so to speak. And this is from 1988, and the Alaska Bar Association addressed a situation of a lawyer who had consummated a transaction for a client knowing that the transaction would breach that client's prior contractual obligations. And the Alaska Bar Association said that that advice of the lawyer was not a violation, even though it ultimately concealed and affected a breach of another contract. And so that's an important fault line to keep in mind. Advising people on structuring contracts that may result in breaches of other contracts is not an ethics violation. But as we go to our next slide, let's look at this carefully because the question of what's illegal suddenly gets very murky when we go from advising breaches of contracts to other types of behavior. And so In re Rosen from New Jersey is the bookend to our Alaska case where you have a lawyer who was giving advice to a client on a series of real estate transactions. And they knew that the real estate engagements and transactions being structured would ultimately affect breaches of contract. But because of the nature of those breaches of contract under New Jersey law, the contracts at root were shifting burdens from buyers to sellers in the real estate transactions. And those breaches were also violations of state regulatory law in that space, given the nature of that area of real estate regulation. And so because of that, the New Jersey Supreme Court found that The lawyer did suffer discipline. It was a public reprimand for assisting with violations of regulatory requirements, even though they were not criminal or fraudulent. The court did find him deceptive. And so that's an example, perhaps, where it may not be criminal or fraudulent, but if it's a regulatory breach, it can be deemed illegal. And there have been other cases around the country like that in terms of non-criminal, non-fraudulent, but regulatory violations that can trip illegality or deceptive lines that trigger bar punishment. And for those of you who practice in securities area, it's particularly important to keep in mind because advising violations, for example, of Sarbanes-Oxley has been found by other courts to be an analog to this New Jersey opinion. So we have to be very, very careful in watching for that area because even though there's no criminal overlay, there can still be ethics violations. So our next slide, as you can see, is mind the risks. The issues to keep mind of here, of course, are that there are malpractice risks of advising clients implicitly to a course of conduct that can lead to liability, and then you get blamed. And so we have to keep in mind that there's a boomerang here. So we can dispense advice, and we can do it carefully, put it in writing to make sure that it does not come back as a boomerang, and you have a client say, oh my gosh, I thought I had the right to do this. It needs to be in writing, it needs to be crystal clear to avoid that malpractice boomerang. Keep in mind that civil regulatory violations and advice on them could actually end up tripping ethics wires depending upon your jurisdiction. But more importantly, and what should send shivers down all of your spines, is the idea, as you see on our next bullet point here, of being a co-defendant with your client. We have breach of fiduciary duty liability is one scenario. And here we have the case Adina versus Cohen coming out of Pennsylvania that found a lawyer could be sued on an aiding and abetting theory when the lawyer's advice to a general partner in a partnership resulted in the general partner breaching a fiduciary duty. And so the other partners who sued for breach of fiduciary duty roped in the lawyer on an aiding and abetting theory, and the court allowed that to stand. And you can get more specific here. You see from the Illinois state courts a more general proposition in terms of lawyers being liable for the aiding and abetting of torts of their clients. Here we have a case where the court held, quote, we see no reason to impose a per se bar that prevents imposing liability on attorneys who knowingly assist their clients in causing another party's injuries. This leads to the third bullet point here, and that's intentional torts. And here you see a quote from the Montana Supreme Court saying that ordinarily a lawyer may not be held liable for interference with contractual relationships when advising a client who chooses to breach. That's good for us on that side of it. But if you look at Illinois, you can see on the other side, holding a claim against a lawyer for tortious interference with a contract must allege actual malice, where they say, quote, such allegations, however, would necessarily include a desire to harm, which is independent of and unrelated to the attorney's desire to protect his client. So although difficult to plead, it could be pled. So these issues of advising in areas of laws and rule breaking then accelerate in complexity when we start running into civil disobedience. And as you see on our next slide, we get to the issue of advising civil disobedience organizations or clients who may engage in civil disobedience. Ultimately, before you get involved in adding civil disobedience advice to your practice, it's important to consider that there are possibilities of legal malpractice that can come out of these situations. That's one thing to be focused on. The next thing to be focused on is that you as lawyers could actually theoretically be indicted or sued for negligent misrepresentation, violating consumer protection statutes, fraud, civil rights, all sorts of things. That big picture descending point is important to keep in mind as you enter this realm and start giving advice. And so the practical tip here is that this is a knife's edge. The ethics rules as well as the malpractice boomerang for overstepping bounds have to be kept in mind and are very, very important. And so there are two tips that come out of this if you're in the situation where you have a client or an organization or an individual who wants some advice to participate in civil disobedience and you're giving out the advice. And remember, as you know from many of your other ethics programs, if it may be a client in a very formal setting where you have an engagement agreement and you feel that you're being asked to give legal advice, you're being paid for it, but lawyers can be on the hook for giving advice in all manner of situations that may feel more off the cuff depending upon the circumstances. We have to be careful. The first tip, advise in writing the lines of the law and do not advise a client to break the law. That has to be kept in mind as a massive, massive fault line. It's one thing, as we noted in the very, very beginning, to give advice about what the law allows, what it doesn't allow, and the consequences for that. But it's also important to make sure that even if we're wrapped up in the emotion of these things, we do not advise, go ahead and do it, it's okay to break the law. That would be a trip line we have to be careful on. Tip two, stay in your lane. So, and what I mean by this is, there are organizations and there are lawyers who specialize in giving advice to people participating in civil disobedience, to organizations structuring civil disobedience. And you really want to recommend and refer, probably before taking it upon yourself, to those specialized organizations, because there are all manner of legal pitfalls that exist in that area. I mean, one that we could footnote is there can be heightened consequences of an arrest for example, a non-citizen. So it may be that the organization has come to you and a group of people have come to you and they're going to go out and they're willing to be arrested. And it may be a slap on the wrist. It may just be to make a point. They may know that. But if one of them is not a citizen, you as a lawyer need to be make sure you're dispensing the advice that a non-citizen could face a whole host of different consequences upon arrest. Maybe DHS comes and picks them up. Maybe they get put into removal proceedings. Maybe that conduct could deny them the ability to stop the removal under the immigration laws, for example. Very, very complex stuff that you have to be very, very careful on and recognize that there's a lot of ripples flowing out here that we need to be aware of as lawyers. So, now we're going to shift from the advising module to the participating module on our next slide, as you can see. So now we're looking at participating and the lines between being a lawyer and a free citizen. And we're looking at where lawbreaking in acts of civil disobedience meet your ethical duties as a member of the bar. Rule 8.4b, which is an exemplary rule, prohibits lawyers from engaging in illegal conduct that adversely reflects on the lawyer's honesty, trustworthiness, or fitness as a lawyer. Now, the comment to 8.4 makes clear that lawyers can refuse to follow laws if they have a reasonable good faith belief that the law is, for example, unconstitutional or invalid. And so the bottom line from this is that peaceful civil disobedience is one thing, but vandalism or putting people in danger will be something completely different. So peaceful protesting, even past curfew or on a public land, are generally not the types of things that trigger Section 8.4. On our next slide, though, you can see when it comes to civil disobedience in the context of bar rules, we actually have a massive amount of unclarity, lack of clarity in where and what we can do as lawyers. And so if your primary and the theories behind lawyers and legal regulations here have not been fully fleshed out by the state bars, and so we don't have crystal clear rules, we don't have crystal clear bar opinions on this, we have some conflicting decisions we're going to look at, and a lot of how these cases would be analyzed are driven by and a function of who decides and who is perceiving what is the role of a lawyer in society. And so if the primary obligation is to uphold the law, then one's ability to engage in civil disobedience or counsel clients to do so may be reduced or looked at through a slightly different lens. In other words, by agreeing to be a lawyer and being bound by ethical constraints, the theory is that lawyers are held to a different standard. And so while others can violate laws, perhaps we're held to a higher duty and we cannot without suffering also some ethical violations. In other words, the act of becoming a lawyer arguably forsakes future civil disobedience and intentional rule breaking in a way that would not lead to ethical problems. Of course, the civil disobedience could lead to criminal problems, which are a given, but it's the additional ethical overlay and the state bar punishment that could flow. And that theory finds footing in the idea that lawyers do have different standards to non-lawyers. For example, the attorney-client privilege protects us from criminal sanctions, for example, if we fail to reveal known information, even though a non-lawyer who knows that could be criminally prosecuted, theoretically, for refusing to divulge the information. And at root, the bar rules are simply unclear, and that lack of clarity itself creates a massive fault line. So let's look at this massive fault line. The first case is In re Hallinan from the California Supreme Court in 1966, and this involved a young lawyer, Hallinan, seeking admission to the state bar. And just as an interesting aside, this young lawyer, Hallinan, we're going to look at his father, who I already mentioned earlier, Vince Hallinan, who was a famed civil rights lawyer from San Francisco in the 1940s and 50s and 60s, and his problems that came earlier in the Harry Bridges case when we get to that in a little while. But here we're looking at Vince Hallinan's son, Helen and Junior, who applied to get admission to the California State Bar and faced a problem because of his multiple arrests in the 1960s civil rights movements for civil disobedience. It was nonviolent, peaceful sit-ins. And he faced denial, and that went to the California Supreme Court that said, no, that type of behavior does not disqualify him from admission to the bar. Indeed, they noted it could be a form of the highest form of moral courage. And so there we have an example, a very important case, indicating that civil disobedience like that was not a bar to admission to the legal bar. And it was the role of the criminal authorities to punish him for his nonviolent peaceful sit-ins. And so that opinion would cast a shadow, arguably, that would allow lawyers to engage in similar conduct and not be subject to ethical sanctions. Now, keep in mind one big factual distinction that could apply, and that is that he was not a lawyer and he was seeking admission to the bar. And so the ethics rules that we're talking about, 1.2.1 and 8.4, for example, didn't apply to him yet. It was a question of whether his prior conduct would render him ineligible to be a lawyer. Once you're a lawyer and you're subject to those rules, it could suffer from a different interpretation. And so the case is not on all fours, in other words. And so it's something to keep in mind. And that's especially important when we go to the flip side and we look at this case coming from the post-World War II period that went all the way to the U.S. Supreme Court, actually. And this is In re Summers. And it dealt with a very famous University of Pennsylvania law school professor, Clyde Summers, who had been a conscientious objector in World War II. And he was a beloved professor, a famed professor. And he was, as a result, denied an admission to the Illinois State Bar. He challenged that and went up to the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court affirmed the denial of bar admission to him, even though his pacifist views prevented him from complying with the laws. And what the Supreme Court ultimately affirmed in terms of the rulings coming out of Illinois was that Illinois had a state constitutional requirement that applicants had to serve in the state militia during war. He was unwilling to and refused to do so, and that could be grounds to disqualify him from admission to the bar. And so that stands on the books today as an opinion, as an example, perhaps, of some of the greatest forms of civil disobedience when we're talking about conscientious objectors. And so there you have a lawyer, a law professor, who was denied admission to a bar for conduct that perhaps if you looked at the Hallinan case in the 1960s from California, you would think we'd come to a different decision. Now we're going to shift to a sidebar, and that is judges and social protesting. And this comes from 2020 because we're in the midst of these events, and the California Supreme Court gave an advisory opinion, noting that because of the intense societal focus on these events, judges want to know what they can do. And as the Supreme Court noted, a judge's participation is likely to be the subject of public scrutiny. And so judges have to accept certain restrictions that might be viewed as burdensome by other members of the community. Ultimately, what the court's saying is that judges are held to a different standard to the average citizen because they've given up some rights by becoming a lawyer, and then on top of that, by becoming a judge. And so the Supreme Court really frames the decision in terms of should they walk out there and protest and in a way that's breaking the law they were looking at, obviously factually, civil disobedience, or should they just write about it? And the conclusion is that it's safer to be on the writing versus the walking side of that line, at least. And they can help avoid the risks that come. And so I think what that shows is that, you know, providing an opinion or a written statement to the press perhaps may be the best choice for judges who want to speak on these massive social issues, and that's how the Ethics Committee came down. And while that's true for judges, it's probably true for lawyers too, although lawyers are not held to the same standard, of course, as judges. But it's one way to look at these issues and understand how these issues are being framed today, and that is, if we take the conscientious objector case, we take the Hallinan case, we take this opinion for judges, which is one step further than us as non-judges, as lawyers, we can recognize that we're in that middle zone there where we need to be careful when it comes to civil disobedience and the risk of ethics charges. Now, well, let's do a quick note on our next slide here where we cross and we transcend the realm of ethics just to straight criminal behavior. And so we have the famous indictment, at least, coming in 2020 from the protests of two New York lawyers, a Molotov cocktail, and a police car. And here you see the line in the indictment where the lawyers were these two lawyers in New York have been charged in New York for approaching a New York Police Department vehicle, lighting a Molotov cocktail, and tossing it into the car and then damaging the car. And so two lawyers have been indicted for that behavior. And you know, whether it's true or not hasn't been determined yet, so it's not for me to obviously opine on that. But if those facts were true, that type of criminal conduct would lead to some sort of criminal punishment, presumably or potentially, but it would also then lead to ethics violations and ethics charges by the New York State Bar under the New York rules that we looked at in the beginning and the California rules. So let's shift to civil disobedience and what is civil disobedience here, or is it just plain illegal conduct? And so you may be thinking that you as a lawyer can make creative arguments to deal with perhaps illegal conduct you get charged with and say, no, I was engaged in civil disobedience, or a good faith argument to change the law, and somehow you can use that to get out of things. And there have been some creative lawyers who've tried it and it hasn't worked. And so let's look at those. Alaska, we have Mr. Preston. And there, when facing an ethics charge involving distributing drugs and the claim by the lawyer that it was an act of civil disobedience intended to change the law, the court, the Alaska court at least, concluded that no, that's an ethics violation and you don't get to distribute drugs as a means of, and claim that it's civil disobedience to change the drug laws. And similarly, we have a lawyer in Minnesota who failed to pay court fees and contended that that was an act of civil disobedience because the system was broken and needed reform. And the court said, no, that's not a sufficient basis to get out of paying court fees. You need to pay those court fees. So this gets to the ethics tips in civil disobedience participation for lawyers. Tip number one, peaceful, nonviolent at all times. If we are going to be out there knowingly breaking rules, which is the root of civil disobedience, you know, flouting or violating some sort of governor or police time, place, manner, order that's been done, you better do it in a peaceful, nonviolent manner at all times to the extent you want to possibly argue into the Hallinan type case, if you ever then confronted some sort of ethical prosecution as a result of, you know, a potential criminal prosecution. Keep in mind, you could face a criminal prosecution too. Never involve property damage or violence, otherwise you suddenly start sliding well out of the ethics rules and well into the criminal disciplinary system that we don't want to be in, obviously. Hallinan's the only case on civil disobedience across the country, really, involving bar admissions. And it's a very close analogy to bar punishment, but it's not perfect and it's not a guarantee. And that's why we need to keep in mind that important conscientious objector case, which is still good law all the way up to the U.S. Supreme Court. Avoid trying to make creative arguments that you're engaged in civil disobedience if you're trying to get out of other general laws and generally applicable laws and punishments. And for our judges, let's keep in mind that they are held, you are held, to an even higher standard than lawyers. So you need to be even more careful because of the additional ethical obligations that are taken on when the robe is taken on in terms of one's conduct vis-a-vis society. So now we're going to shift from that module to our litigating module. And our first case we're going to look at is the Chicago 7 trial, the famed trial coming out of the 1968 Democratic Convention events. There were arrests under the federal anti-riot acts, and there was ultimately a 5-month trial against several defendants that led to guilty verdicts and lawyers ultimately being held in contempt on and being blamed for the clients for the violence that occurred in Chicago in that summer, and the lawyers for their behavior at trial. And there you can see that the most famous sketch that came out of that trial, the really shocking, startling sketch of defendant Bobby Seale bound and gagged in trial in front of the jury and the judge, who had been bound and gagged in the order of the judge. And that's coincidentally a famous sketch by famed American illustrator Howard Brody, who did another sketch that'll show up in another one of our slides in a little while here. But in any event, what happened is the Bobby Seale's case was ultimately mistried as a result of that bounding and gagging, binding and gagging. And this was an extremely emotional and rancorous case. And there you see on our next slide the remaining six defendants of the Chicago 7 who ultimately went through the 5-month trial, they were ultimately convicted. And as a result of that trial, the defense attorneys, Kunstler and Weinglass, were charged with contempt for comments they made, and they were charged with aiding their client outbursts at trial. And so you can see on our next slide some quotes of who said what. And there we have a photograph of our famed two defense lawyers who were very, very famous American lawyers, of course, from the time. And we have defense lawyer Kunstler speaking to the court as follows. Mr. Kunstler says, I want to comment on this, Your Honor, because I think what you have just said is about the most outrageous statement I have ever heard from a bench. And I'm going to say my piece right now, and you can hold me in contempt right now if you wish to. You violated every principle of fair play when you excluded Ramsey Clark from the witness stand. The New York Times, among others, has called it the ultimate outrage in American justice. I have sat here for 4.5 months and watched the objections denied and sustained by Your Honor, and I know this is not a fair trial. I know it in my heart. If I have to lose my license to practice law and if I have to go to jail, I can't think of a better cause to go to jail for and to lose my license for, and that Your Honor is wholly responsible for that. And if this is what your career is going to end on, if this is what your pride is going to be built on, I can only say to Your Honor, good luck to you. I'm going to turn back to my seat with the realization that everything I've learned throughout my life has come to naught, and there's no meaning in this court, and there's no law in this court, and these men are going to jail by virtue of a legal lynching. So you can see those comments are pretty profound for a lawyer. This is for an actual practicing lawyer to say to a judge. For all of us, that would be, you know, well outside the bounds of the type of thing we're used to seeing. And you can see that commentary and that kind of passion comes very close to what we saw with Al Pacino in the beginning. This is someone who has lost faith in the system, who's frustrated by the judge and by what the judge is doing, and at that point is now fighting with the judge about the impropriety of the judge and the judge's behavior in a very, I guess we could say, aggressive manner. And you can see a quote from Weinglass, the other lawyer on the left, at one point said to the judge, "The door in this courtroom seems to swing in one direction against the defendants." And at another point, he referred to the trial judge as being inhumane, disgraceful, and even accused the judge of dishonesty. And so the result of that, as you can see on our next slide, they got 4 years, a sentence of 4 years Mr. Kunstler got in jail for that behavior. I mean, that's a staggering sentence to receive for contempt. So what happened? Let's go to our next slide. And we see here, this is the generally governing ethics rule of law that applies. This comes from Sasher versus United States, 343 U.S. 1 at page 9. And the U.S. Supreme Court has said, of course, it is the right of counsel for every litigant to press his claim, even if it appears far-fetched and untenable, to obtain the court's considered ruling. Full enjoyment of that right, with due allowance for the heat of controversy, will be protected by appellate courts when infringed by trial courts. But if the ruling is adverse, it is not counsel's right to resist it or to insult the judge. His right is only respectfully to preserve his point for appeal. So, working with that governing principle in mind, let's now look at what happened in the appeal to the Seventh Circuit from the trial judge's contempt rulings. And this is, In re Dellinger is the name of the case that then took up these rulings of the trial judge on contempt for the lawyers. And the Seventh Circuit, as you can see here, held, while regretting the necessity, therefore, we conclude that all 9 contemptors must be tried before another judge. And so ultimately it was remanded for a new contempt trial. So what we can see there from the opinion is that the Seventh Circuit was deeply frustrated by the behavior of the lawyers, but for a whole variety of reasons believed that procedurally, the aggrieved trial judge, who had been at war basically with these defense lawyers, for lack of a better word, was not the appropriate judge to be handing down contempt verdicts against them, precisely because he was himself too enmeshed in a participant in this back and forth. And what the court said is that it's, you know, noting that Supreme Court principle that lawyers need to make their objections and take them up on appeal if they're frustrated. But at the same time, what the Seventh Circuit noted is that, look, a lawyer doesn't have to stay quiet when charged with misconduct by a judge and can respond to a judge's rejoinder. I mean, if a judge is going to assault a lawyer, in other words, especially in front of a jury with accusations, a lawyer has the right to respond to that rejoinder. And that additional response just can't be deemed contemptuous because one is defending themselves against a charge being made by a judge. And so that is an important principle to keep in mind in terms of a line. It's an important principle for judges in terms of the idea of issuing charges and sanctions and misconduct against lawyers in front of juries. And if doing so by making assertions and allegations and charges and findings, lawyers will then defend themselves back as they have the right to do. And that act of defending oneself cannot itself be deemed contemptuous, subject to being punished. At the same time, the court held, because remember, part of the charges against the lawyers were that they had encouraged the Abby Hoffman and the rest of the Chicago 7, or the 6 that were remaining, to engage in outbursts in the court and sort of social protests within the court, so to speak, to challenge the judge, the trial, the proceedings, the legitimacy of everything. And they were charged with aiding and abetting, in other words, and that was part of the contempt claim against them. And what the Seventh Circuit held is that, well, no, it's not that simple. An attorney has no affirmative obligation to restrain his client under pain of the contempt sanction, although we do not express an opinion as to the breach of professional ethics that may be involved in the situation. And so that's a very important point. It may not be contemptuous of the court. You may not be able to be sanctioned for contempt if you simply sit quietly by and watch your client engage in outbursts and you do nothing. You may be able to do that and avoid a contempt charge from the court, but they noted it's an open question as to whether sitting idly by on your client, for whom you have obligations to and you have some ability to engage with, obviously, that could trip ethics wires. So it's an important point to keep in mind in terms of us as lawyering in court in these social, socio-political, you know, highly emotional trials coming out of civil disobedience acts and civil disobedience trials, where you can follow, you know, afar of the ethics lines also. And then finally, what the court noted here is that mere disrespect or insult cannot be punished where it does not involve an actual and material obstruction. This is particularly true with respect to attorneys where the heat of the courtroom debate may prompt statements which are ill-considered and might later be regretted. And so this is a fascinating, this is really a fascinating point, because what the court ultimately was saying is that, yes, the lawyers were saying comments that were incendiary and were insulting to the judge, but what the Seventh Circuit also said is that while those comments were certainly striking at the, and I think the quote was, the most vulnerable and human qualities of a judge's temperament, that's what required a public hearing before a different judge on the contempt charges. And at the same time, what the Seventh Circuit actually said is that there has to be substantial freedom of expression for a lawyer in this kind of an area, precisely because, and this is a direct quote, judges are supposed to be men of fortitude, able to thrive in a hardy climate. In other words, there's a lot of grit that we expect our judges to have, and they shouldn't be so thin-skinned that if they accuse lawyers of misconduct, lawyers make some sort of defense of themselves, that the judge would be horrified and shocked and weakened and requiring to send lawyers to jail for 4 years. And so ultimately what came out of this then is that the Seventh Circuit looked at this and said, yes, there was a pattern of refusals to obey court orders and to cease arguments, and that is the type of behavior that can justify contemptuous findings and orders. But at the same time, just because the lawyers, some of the commentary from the lawyers wasn't necessarily contemptuous because the judge's statements demanded and required and justified a rejoinder from the lawyer. And so ultimately what what the Seventh Circuit said, as you can see on our next question here, is what happened on remand? They sent it back. And it was sent back and assigned to a district judge in Maine, randomly picked by Chief Justice Berger, to decide who was going to, you know, ultimately hear this case on remand. And the new district judge found the lawyers in contempt based upon the factual findings. Not all of their behavior was contemptuous, because some of the stuff asked for rejoinder and that made it okay. But their behavior was ultimately found to be contemptuous. And then the United States attorney said that the lawyers should get 6 months in jail. They backed off of the 4 years in jail, but still argued for 6 months in jail. And the district judge in Maine said no, that jail was not necessary, and it, you know, precisely because the behavior of the lawyers could not be considered independent and apart from the behavior of the trial judge, but also the behavior of the prosecutors and their conduct. And ultimately, all of them were participants in this system who had, you know, effectively raised the ante. Each of them were raising the ante as this thing went along, and they were all engaged in behavior that prickled and poked at everyone. And so within the broader social context of that trial, so to speak, the social context, there were raised tensions that everyone was a participant in. And so jail is inappropriate. A simple judgment of contempt, a public reprimand, rebuke, in other words, is enough. And so what's fascinating here ultimately also, as we can note as an aside, is that the Seventh Circuit ultimately reversed the underlying convictions against the defendants No new charges were ever filed. The use of the Anti-Riot Act itself was understood to be, in that case at least, an extreme use of that statute. And indeed, one of the judges in the Seventh Circuit felt the whole statute was unconstitutional and the whole proceeding had been unconstitutional from the beginning, and actually questioned the prosecutors and the court for, quote, tripping the quote, standards of our system of justice. So that shows you an example of what happens in these highly charged, highly emotional civil disobedience cases from the 1960s, where lawyers then were wrapped up in the proceedings and defending their clients in these highly charged cases, and the lawyer's conduct itself became rancorous, as did the prosecutors and the judge. But ultimately, those defense lawyers, although they avoided jail, they did find contempt findings. So now we're going to go back further in time, back to the Cold War, and we're going to see a case where a lawyer was found in contempt and jailed. So this brings us to the Harry Bridges trials. And here, it's a subject matter that I've written a book on. There's a picture of my book, Burning Bridges, which deals with and addresses the 20 years of deportation trials that the U.S. government put Harry Bridges through, four separate trials spanning 20 years that went to the U.S. Supreme Court twice in this effort to deport the Australian labor leader, Harry Bridges, on the basis that he was a member of the Communist Party, which was a legal basis to trigger deportations back in that time period. And this brings us then to, you know, an earlier ism to the 1960s, to communism and the great fear of communism. And his cases started back during the Great Depression, where we had labor protests and red scares and battles on the waterfront, and Harry Bridges rose to prominence out of those, you know, incendiary events up in the San Francisco Embarcadero and on the waterfront, with battles with police and shooting and killing and bombs and all that. And ultimately, he rose from the ashes of that to be a prominent labor leader, and then was immediately charged with being a member of the Communist Party to try to deport him. And he went through a couple of deportation trials and won each of them. The second one went to the U.S. Supreme Court. He won. And he was being subjected to these serial trials by Congress, you know, adopting new laws in part to target him and focus on him to get rid of him. And, you know, the trials are incredible and filled with all the drama you can possibly imagine, as detailed in my book, but it's sort of larger than life characters in all the trials and witnesses and convicted murderers breaking down on the witness stand, crying and admitting to, being forced into perjury by the government. I mean, it's unbelievable stuff, drama. That's remarkable. But this is now unfolding over a couple of trials, and the second trial goes to the U.S. Supreme Court, and again, the U.S. Supreme Court in the second trial says, no, there's no basis to deport him. He has, you know, he's not a member of the Communist Party. And so at that point, he had won twice, even with the word of the U.S. Supreme Court. So he then goes and swears in a naturalization ceremony as a citizen. And that's what gets us to this case we're going to talk about now, because when he swore under penalty of perjury an oath to be a citizen, part of that oath was, I've never been a member of the Communist Party. And so he swore it, having won two prior trials on that point. The moment he swore that in, the U.S. government then indicted him in the third trial for perjury in making that statement. And so then that sets the groundwork for what's now a federal criminal prosecution in front of a jury up in San Francisco, and for lying for perjury. And so that trial is a highly politicized trial. We're now in 1950, the height of the late 1949-1950, the height of the Red Scare, Senator McCarthy, the whole nine yards, you know, from history, you know, the blacklisting, Hollywood witch trials and all that. So Vince Hallinan is a very well-known brawler of a trial lawyer, you know, just sort of a rugged trial lawyer who has been battling it out in San Francisco courts, kind of a very well-known, highly regarded trial lawyer at the time. And Harry Bridges hires him to be his trial lawyer to defend this case. And the judge, and there's more detail in the book than you need here, but the judge and Vince Hallinan had a prior run-in many years ago, where Hallinan actually had felt the judge had tried to pressure him to engage in misconduct as a lawyer to the benefit of someone else. And so they'd had some prior bad blood when that judge was a state judge. Now he's a federal judge. And the headwinds that frame the case then are that Vince Hallinan's argument ultimately to the jury is that there's no perjury here. My guy has been cleared twice, once by the U.S. Supreme Court, and he really is being subjected to what ultimately is a conspiracy by public and private partnership to deport him, because he's a powerful labor leader thumbing his nose in the eyes of industry and the employers' associations and the like. And so that's his theory of the case, that all of this is literally trumped up, made up stuff. And so in his opening statement, he starts saying things which immediately lead to him being shut down. And so you can see here some quotes. He's saying, telling the jury about what how he believes the trial is going to unfold, which is the labor movement, as you may have all observed at times in my career, turns back on itself and renders and destroys itself and engages in internecine quarrels that destroy its utility. And the judge shut him down and told him this isn't going to be a trial about the labor protests from the last 15, 20 years and what was going on and how your guy came to be on the labor front. This is just about perjury. Was he a member? Was he not? We're not getting into this whole history. And then Vince Hallinan in opening, and Vince Hallinan felt that was unfair because he was being severely constrained in terms of what were the case issues that he could talk about. But then he goes on to accuse in opening the government witnesses of being perjurers and liars, comparing them to, quote, bucko mates, violence as wide as the seven seas, end quote. That's the type of thing he said was going to have. And he even said that they're out to kill Bridges. Again, he was shut down. And the judge told him that you don't get to characterize all the government witnesses as being perjurers, low people, bad people. You don't even know who they are. And I think this is unfair for you to sort of speak ill of these people at this time in opening. And so the judge shut him down in opening. And they had huge battles about it on the transcripts. On the very first witness, he starts cross-examining the witness. And the government's first witness was an immigration inspector who had been there when Harry Bridges swore in and all that. And so Hallinan immediately starts cross-examining him, asking him, you know, as you can see there, the question, you know, are you aware of the U.S. Supreme Court and what it said about these trials and the prior trials about Harry Bridges? And that was objected, it was sustained, and the judge told him, again, you don't get to talk about the prior cases. And what this guy knows about prior cases involving immigration and the like got totally nothing to do with this proceeding. That was the judge's position. And then you can see Hallinan's response was, well, I disagree. I'll have to take the position, Your Honor, that I consider very much an error your position, and I'll have to continue to ask such questions as I may deem advised, and I say that you have no right to make up your mind as to whether a conspiracy of these witnesses exists or does not exist. That is something direct to the jury I'll try. And then he kept asking questions about the witness's acquaintance with the decisions, got objections, sustained. He's then arguing with the lawyers. And then they go home. The next morning, they show up to continue, and the judge pulls out a thick pile of papers, reads a lengthy report from the bench detailing what had happened during opening and during the cross-examination by Vince Hallinan. And here you can see a picture of Vince Hallinan, the trial lawyer. And the judge finds him in contempt, disbars him, and orders him imprisoned on the spot. No advance notice, no chance or opportunity to be heard or defend himself. And pandemonium breaks out now in the courtroom. I mean, the marshals descend upon Hallinan to try to take him away. Hallinan holds on to the podium for dear life to make his case and argue about the contempt proceeding. The U.S. attorney then starts joining in and accusing Hallinan of being a, quote, mad dog and frenzied and all this stuff. And as you can see on the next slide, here's an actual piece of the transcript that I photographed from the National Archives, where Mr. Hallinan is now at the podium fighting for literally his life at this point, I guess, from being imprisoned. And the U.S. attorney is now approaching the podium, and Hallinan is frustrated and says, "Might I finish my sentences without this man yelling in my ear? He objects to me standing here." And that's the statement. The U.S. attorney had said he's a mad dog. He's been found in contempt. He has no right to even talk to the court because he's been disbarred from the court as of, 5 minutes ago. So he has no right to even be heard. And so Vince Hallinan is saying, he objects to my standing here. And then he has the effrontery to come up and stand here. "I don't know who he is trying to tempt. At an earlier day, Your Honor, the temptation would be acceded to. But as I say, I'm getting more urbane as I get older." The judge, "They tell me, Mr. Hallinan, perhaps when we grow older, we become a little more temperate. It does not seem so to me. I do, Your Honor, but others do not." And so ultimately, he was ordered to jail. He was for 6 months. He's disbarred and he's held in contempt. And the judge tells, at that point, the other defense lawyer for the other defendants on trial with Bridges, "You defend Harry Bridges." And Harry Bridges and the defense lawyers say, "This is outrageous. That's my lawyer. I want him." And there's a whole melee and back and forth. And the judge ultimately stays execution of his sentence. Allows Hallinan to remain and defend Bridges for the trial, but tells him when the trial's over, you're going off to jail. And so you can only imagine the rancorous trial that then unfolds. It's the stuff of motion pictures. And that then unfolds, and ultimately Harry Bridges is convicted by the jury of perjury and of being a member of the Communist Party. And Vince Hallinan is then sent off by the judge to prison. for contempt for 6 months. And so on the next slide here, you can see another famed sketch from Howard Brody, like the one of Bobby Seale, and that's Vince Hallinan cross-examining a witness with the judge, with the light shining down on the judge in the trial. Just a remarkable picture. But what happens to Hallinan on appeal? He goes up on appeal on the contempt charge, and the Ninth Circuit affirmed. And the Ninth Circuit said, the vice wasn't in bringing the defenses, but the manner in which you did it. And you can see the quote there on the second bullet point, echoing the quote we saw from the U.S. Supreme Court earlier, that at root, all lawyers know that we often disagree on the admissibility of evidence or on trial theories, what you can do, what you can't do. But when the court's spoken, upon counsel is then imposed the duty of abiding by that ruling. That error, if any, is to be corrected elsewhere. That is the cardinal fault line that we as lawyers are forced to live on. Like it or not, we don't get to be Al Pacinos. We got to live on that line. And when we trip that line, we then run into the risk of contempt. And specifically, the Ninth Circuit said, an officer of a court has a higher duty to assist in maintaining the dignity and integrity of courts than an ordinary citizen. This, of course, then is what bridles us and what did not bridle Al Pacino. And so Vince Hallinan, you can see on our next slide here, talking about his fate, he went and served months in prison in freezing Puget Sound. But fascinatingly, Harry Bridges' conviction went all the way up to the U.S. Supreme Court again, and it got reversed again. And Harry Bridges was saved yet again by the U.S. Supreme Court, twice in his life. I mean, truly astounding data points, really. And Vince Hallinan then, you know, as a funny aside, proudly claimed, you know, that he saved Harry Bridges from jail, and he went to jail for him. And it was sort of a badge of honor he wore as a sluggish trial lawyer. And as another little funny arc through history, he noted that when he was in jail, he gave boxing lessons to inmates because he'd been a boxer in his younger days. You know, which is funny because, as you may remember, the charge against his son 20 years later, when he was being denied admission to the state bar, was that he resorted to resolving problems with fisticuffs, was the word, which didn't matter, and he still was able to get admitted to the state bar, so they must have been a boxing family. So, as you can see now, we have our next slide, ethics tips here when we're litigating civil disobedience, high emotion, social, political cases. The tips are important. It's easy to get wrapped up in the broader emotion of these environments, you know, and the cause behind the litigation for which we're fighting as lawyers, but we have to be careful. Breaking the rules of the court can lead to ethics violations and contempt sanctions. And even if one gets out of contempt and just gets a reprimand and maybe doesn't go to jail, there can still be ethics violations that flow from it. And so those are very, very important rules to keep in mind. And the key rule, of course, is that regardless of the emotion, the rancor, how important the trial is, regardless of how unfair the procedures feel to you as a lawyer, we as lawyers have that higher duty. We have to follow the rules of the judge that he lays down in terms of what we can admit, what we can't admit as evidence in front of the jury. And you don't get to engage in the civil disobedience of the judge's rules and just get a slap on the wrist. It can lead to contempt. And so civil disobedience outside the courtroom can lead to perhaps arrests, and if it's peaceful, nonviolent, maybe nothing comes of it. But that kind of analogous behavior in court can lead to legitimate punishments, and even, as we've seen, the jailing of lawyers. And let's look at our next slide, and let's keep this in mind because it's really important, and it's a sort of a fascinating way to look at what happened in both these cases. Look at the people who went to jail and the people who didn't go to jail. In both the Chicago 7 trial and in the Harry Bridges trial, and there's a picture of Harry Bridges, they didn't go to jail. But in the pictures on the right side, the lawyers for those people, some went to jail, Vince Hallinan, and others were held in contempt and managed to avoid what would have been a 4-year jail sentence. And so it's a curious point, to say the least, that in all these cases, these heightened emotional frenzied cases, the defendants who felt that they were in civil disobedience social show trials, so to speak, they actually got off and ultimately won and prevailed and were okay. But the lawyers who defended those trials ultimately found themselves in places of misconduct and punishment. And so it's a good data point and learning point to look at, because it shows that we as lawyers, as we all know, when we've been in very emotional pitched cases that are plugging into some of the deeper things going on in society at the time or in that space, can easily trip lines if we're not careful. And we have to keep that hat on and remember our roles as lawyers. So our final slide is our conclusions. And let's go back to our three modules here. Counseling. Stay on the advice side of the line versus assisting clients in criminal fraudulent conduct. advising about breaches of contract may be okay, as you remember those cases, but other torts are not so clear. And so you have to be very, very careful that you don't ultimately aid, for example, torts, fiduciary duty breaches, or in family law cases, child custody violations. And so I think at root, the safest ethics practice for us to adopt when we're in the counseling realm is advise only, articulate the consequences only, do not advise clients to break any kind of a court order or to break the law in any fashion, because it can lead to being a defendant, malpractice claims, or ethics violations. Participating. Peaceful civil disobedience consequences can exist. I mean, we can engage in those knowing violations of, you know, police time, place, manner type restrictions on when you're allowed to gather, protest, and whatnot. We can do that. We may say face some civil consequences from that, or criminal consequences in terms of misdemeanors. It probably won't lead to ethics charges given the California Hallinan case. But we have to keep in mind that old Colorado case, the Illinois case, the conscientious objector case, it could well apply still in some states. And so depending upon where you go in that civil disobedience conduct that you engage in, it may or may not trip these ethics wires. And the other point to keep in mind here as our safest ethics practice is that we can write articles or give speeches and speak about social justice issues and the law and what the law should be doing, since we are all participants in the law and we're experts and masters in the law. That's an area we have an expertise in. And the safest practice is to not break even, you know, minor criminal laws that, you know, in acts of civil disobedience, because you don't know what could be the ethics consequences. And there could be ethics consequences. And one should also just keep in mind as a practical matter that you don't even know how bad things could spin out of control when you're engaged in those protests, and they may suddenly become violent or more problems may happen, in which case you may get wrapped up in something even greater than you intended on the front end. And so keeping in mind, ultimately, if we're talking about the safest ethics principle, keeping in mind ultimately that we as lawyers do engage in some sort of a quid pro quo when we get our bar card, and we are held to and live in a world that has slightly different standards, and depending upon the context, to non-lawyers. And that can have consequences, that has real meaning that we should be serious about and we should remember when it comes to participating. Finally, litigating. As emotional and unfair as a civil disobedience trial may be, and you know, the Chicago 7 was one such trial. It was framed through the legal prism of the Anti-Riot Act, but ultimately it was putting people on trial for being engaged in what they believed was civil disobedience. And the Harry Bridges trial was the same thing. It was trial coming out of the Red Scare, the communist witch hunts, and this persecutory conduct that went on for 20 years against one man without a factual basis. And those are the types of fact patterns that lead to immense emotional and intense passions. And they can bubble up in environmental law and civil rights law. They can bubble up in patent law, dealing with monopolies and David versus Goliath stories. They bubble up everywhere we practice, family custody disputes, as we saw too. And so the point is, in those cases, we as lawyers have to follow the orders of the court that we're litigating in. And the orders of the courts in terms of evidence, objections, whatnot, the amount of time you get with a witness, they all may be unfair, they may be right, they may be wrong. We may be aggrieved by them, we may feel they're unjust and inappropriate, but the remedy is to take that up on appeal. The remedy is not to become contemptuous of the judge and risk contempt and or ethics charges and violations. And so the safest ethics practice, of course, is to follow the judge's orders, appeal bad rulings, don't get into a contemptuous battle with the judge, because that kind of civil disobedience behavior can ultimately lead to sanctions or jail, as Vince Hallinan experienced. And we don't want to end up in jail. We don't want to end up like Al Pacino, violating every manner of ethical rule, as you saw the clip in the beginning of it, and then landing in jail. And so that's our practice today on the ethics of civil disobedience for us as lawyers. I'm out of order, you're out of order. Maybe they're all out of order, but we saw who won, who lost in that battle in terms of who was on the right side of order. If you have any questions, I would love to get emails from you. Please reach out. Thank you.